are you, pal?
I am good. How are you, my friend?
I am really good. I am happy today. We have a guest that I have not seen, really, I think maybe since the finale. And I used to see her all the time.
No, I saw her last year at the 20th anniversary. We had dinner at Del Posto after the big event. We sat together with Victoria and Kathrine sat with us. She's a great actress, beloved character, Charmaine Bucco.
And keeps on working as the years go on, working as much, if not more than anybody, in huge projects. She was just
and before The Sopranos too. Yeah.
Just incredible. Yeah. And she's so good, which we've brought up so many times in season one and season two, how good our next guest is. Let's please welcome our friend Charmaine Bucco, Kathrine Narducci. Come on down. There she is. Hey. How are you?
I'm very good. Now that I see you two.
Good to see you. Good to see you. You look great.
Thank you. Yeah.
You look fantastic.
Who are you guys?
Where are you?
I'm in the Bronx. You're in the Bronx.
Yeah. Very cool.
That's great. Have you been in New York the whole time?
For the pandemic?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You've been here the whole time. Yeah. Yeah. I was there for a couple months and then I came to California.
And I did it solo. Very few people did it solo.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, good for you. So let me ask you, Kathrine, and some of the stuff I know, but there's a lot of people out there. A lot of people have been asking you to be a guest on our show. And you have a very unusual story how you got started. So tell us. How exactly, your first movie was The Bronx Tale, I believe. How did that happen?
Well, first of all, I was a closet case actress. My family did, I was in the closet. My family didn't really know what I was doing and I would go on these secret auditions.
Oh.
The only person who knew was my one aunt. So anytime I would bring it up, because I already had two kids, I was a single parent. And anytime I told somebody I want to be an actor, it was like, what are you talking about? You're too old. You have kids. What are you going to do? None of that, you know, encouragement in this neighborhood, right? And not in a bad way. They're just logical thinkers. You know, you get a job, you need to make money. You're a mother. You can't be. So I really kept it to myself. So I was at my job at the Hunts Point Terminal Market. I was working in the billing department. And I would always make them laugh and do all these crazy things. And I was going on these secret auditions, as I said. And the woman, Annabella, said to me, you know, De Niro is having an open call. He's doing a movie that he's directing and they have an open call for a little boy. You should take your son. And I said, all right, if I take my son, then I get to meet De Niro. I really didn't know how it worked. I said, then I can meet De Niro and maybe I can get in the movie too. So I took my son, Nicholas, who you both of you have met.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. He was 7 years old at the time. And he came out. When he came out, I saw the women that were going in for the wife role. I didn't know the wife was for De Niro's wife. These girls started coming in that looked like me, walked like me, talked like me. And they sat down. They were signing in. And I said, what are you guys here for? And they said, we're here for mother. And I had no idea what that was, what were the details, whose wife, mother it is. I said, oh, when she came out with my son, I said, can I go in for the mother? And she said, well, that is not an open call. You have to be an actor. I said, I'm not, you know, in the union, but I'm an actor. So she said to me, well, if we don't find the mother, a union mom today, we're going to open it. That is going to be an open call to tomorrow. So call me in the morning and we'll let you know. So I called her in the morning. I woke up. Me and my son went home. I woke up. I was ready to go to work. Called her in the morning. I said I was there yesterday. She said, okay. I went over there. I put myself on tape. And I got a call 2 days later. Bob saw your tape. And it's just a long story. It's a beautiful long story, and I don't want to get into it, but I went down. I went to beating out 2,500 girls, and I got the role.
When you said you were going on secret auditions, were you in a class, or were you looking up auditions in the backstage, in the newspaper?
I was going backstage, and I was going on any single thing that I applied for. If it was singing, if it was... No. I went one time on an audition, and they said, oh, a very famous band, lead singer, is pregnant. We're looking for the lead singer. And I called my aunt. I said, you're going to call me on this one. It's for a lead singer from a big band. There's a band that one of the girls got pregnant. We get down there, the guy tells me, he goes, you know, this is En Vogue. The lead singer from En Vogue's pregnant. I said, okay. I walked in the room. He goes, so what are you going to sing for us? I was like, I don't know. I can't really remember a full song or anything, but I could sing something. And I started singing Good Morning Heartache by Billy Holiday.
That's what you got to do to start out. I started with backstage too. I would just go on all these for off Broadway plays that didn't pay any money, and you'd spend like your whole day waiting to be seen to do a monologue in some shit theater in the stairwell. You're waiting in the stairwell with like 200 people. I mean,
Those are the good old days.
That's how I did it. Yeah, backstage and show business were newspapers that came out every week. Now they're online, I guess. But you used to go to the newsstand, you buy it, and they had, sometimes they'd have big movies, like Hollywood movies would do open calls very rarely. Usually it was like student films, NYU films, plays, commercials, that kind of thing.
Hey, Kathrine, so when they did call you in, you went on tape in the casting director's office for The Bronx Tale. Did they give you the sides? I mean, what, did they just give it to you?
The reason I got the role was the improv part, and I only know that because Bob told me. So when I got there, they gave me new sides. It wasn't the same scene. And Bob said, you know, we're gonna improvise a little bit. I'm gonna say something, you're gonna say something back, and just go along, go with the flow. And I said, okay. So first thing he did, which I wanted to die. He just looked at me. We read. He goes, all right, that's good. Put that away. Now we're going to improvise. As soon as I put the paper down, he goes, Rosina, come over here. Sit on my lap. And I was just like, oh, my God. So I got up. I walked over, and I sat on his lap, and he grabbed me. And he looked at me, and he said, do you know you're just as beautiful as the day I married you? And I looked at him, and I just turned around, and I was like, oh, my God. And I just went like that. And he's going like this to me, hey. And I'm like, he's like, gotta say something back. I told you, we're going to improvise. I said, I know, but organically and naturally, when somebody tells me I'm pretty, I get shy. I don't say anything back. So I didn't feel the need to say anything back. And he looked at me, I'm Chaz, like, are you sure you're not an actress? I was like, no. And then he got up, he starts screaming about the kid. I don't take care of this kid. And he's driving a bus. So I jumped up and I started going back with him. And we were going around the room. It was a lot of great energy. And when I was done, he said, you know, there's going to be, there's a chance here that you may get called back. And I said, oh, great. When I got home, we had answering machines back then, and it was Ellen Chenoweth, and she said, oh, Bob wants you to come back. You know, you're going to come back and do the same thing. And it went on and on. A couple of times I've gone back, like four or five times. And then the last time they said, you know, we're going to do a screen test, and this is where you're going to dress up like a character, and they're going to have a set, and you're going to do it. There's going to be somebody else there that you're up against. And, that was that.
And were you nervous, or because you didn't, I mean,
I was nervous, but I was nervous, but really not that nervous. It was odd.
Nervous, yeah.
I felt very comfortable. And I even said it in the tape when they said, after you read the signs, we want you to tell us something about yourself. Tell us something about you. When I was out on the Avenue and I read Before I Met Bob, And I said, well, I know one thing for sure about myself. I know I'm supposed to be here today. Wow. So I think I just felt that. And not in an egotistical way. I just thought this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Well, you were right.
Absolutely. Now, Kathrine, did you grow up in the Bronx or in...
I grew up in Harlem.
You grew up in East Harlem, right? Near Ray,
yeah. Ray,
right?
Over there.
Yeah. And then I moved to the Bronx when I always forget what age I was. I think I was 22 or 23.
Oh. And now after you did the Bronx Tale, did you start getting regular work, or was it after the movie came out, or you got an agent, or how, what happened after that?
Well, the movie got me an agent, and then I got a Law and Order right after that. Thank God for Law and Order, right?
For everybody.
I got a Law and Order right away, and then I got the remake of The Miracle on 34th Street, a small cameo in that. And little things, nothing big. It was nothing big, you know. And even when the movie came out, it was still nothing really big. It was always just like a guest star, part of the movie. Nothing really big.
Yeah, you had a big role. You had a nice role in The Bronx Tale. That was a real, I mean, you had a lot of screen time there. Did you keep your job at Hunts Point, which people don't know, it's a huge... What, fruit market, right?
Yeah.
Food market, different foods, yeah.
And did you keep your job the whole time, or did you pack it in and just try the
act? I quit my job because, you know, I got my answer. I got my answer what I was supposed to be doing. And I never thought, like, when I quit my job, I didn't go in there like, I'm going to be some big actress. That was never even real. I swear, it never crossed my mind. Even the not knowing, being a dumb young actress that I didn't even know really what improv meant, I really did not ever think I'm going to be a big actress because of this. And it wasn't low self-esteem. I have a very good confidence. I just was more realistic and just, it was just what I loved, and I was doing what I loved. And that was so enough for me. I didn't think anything else. I didn't future trip. Oh, I'm going to be this. Or this is going to get me. I'm playing De Niro's wife. I never thought like that, ever.
And with The Sopranos, did you audition for Charmaine, or did you audition for different characters?
I auditioned for Edie Falco's role.
For Carmela?
Yeah.
Oh.
And did you audition with Jim, or did you just go in first on tape?
I mean, Kathy Moriarty called me. And she said, "No, Duch, there's a show. It's called The Sopranos. And like us all, we all thought it was about singing." And she said, "You know, I'm going to be screen tested for it, and it's a great show, and you should find out about it." And I called my agent. I said, "Kathy Moriarty just told me this is a good show. I might be right for it." And they looked. They said, "Okay, we got you an audition." And I went in for Edie Falco role. So
who was Kathy screen testing for? Do you know? Was it Edie Falco wrote also?
Yeah.
For Carmela.
For Carmela.
Yeah, for Carmela.
And so you read for Edie's role. Obviously, you didn't get it. Then they said, try this. What?
Yeah.
Did you read for David? What happened?
Yeah, I went in. I read for everybody. They were all there, that big long table. That was nerve-wracking. I was nervous for that. I was more nervous for that than I was for Bronxelite. I mean, A Bronx Tale, I never had that whole table setting, like 25 right. people just waiting for you to just open your mouth.
Yeah.
So for that, yes, everybody was there. And then that I got a call that night, George and Walken said they loved you. They want you to come in. There's another role. They definitely, you know, want you to be a part of the show. And there's a role that you're another role you're right for. Come down and read. And I got that right away.
And you had to read for the same group? All those people again?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that's unbelievable.
You know, when they shot the pilot, right? They started screening it I think you know this, but I'm going to just bring it up for the fans. When they started screening the pilot to see if they wanted to go on with the series, HBO, they screened it for test audiences. And Charmaine, your character was the highest testing character, the most likable character in the tests.
No way.
You didn't know that?
No.
Because they felt that she stood up to the mob and they liked that, that you were, you had principles about standing up for them. And Charmaine was, if not the, one of the highest testing characters, the most liked in the pilot.
So funny. Yeah, then everybody ends up loving Jimmy and hating me because I was so mean to him all the time.
Well, you were kind of, you know, people thought you were a bitch, but you were the voice of reason for the show. You were anti-mob. You were a businesswoman.
Yeah, she had
a businesswoman
principles.
Trying to raise a family. I mean, you were, you didn't do anything bad throughout the show.
You know, it always confused me, that character, because I was always breaking David Chase's chops about... And it, again, it's not about me wanting screen time or more. It was about me wanting to make sense to me as Kathrine, wanting to make sense of what I'm doing and who I'm playing. And I felt like I understand there's a voice of reason. I always knew who I was and what I was supposed to be representing. But I always felt like, I wish they would have wrote the lighter kind of side more for Charmaine Bucco. Like, why do I have all this hate? So I gave it to myself. And one day I said to David Chase, you know, I have to justify why I can't stand Tony. Because I feel like I would have made some kind of turnaround. Like, he's always being nice to me. And for my own character, why? What is it that I got against this guy? Like, come on, I grew up in that kind of a neighborhood. Why do I hate him so much? He comes, he brings me business. We were struggling with the restaurant. They were the only ones who gave us business. Like, I had to rectify it for myself. So I gave myself a backstory. I said, when Camilla went away that summer, and I give her the, I said, I fucked Tony.
You could say that.
I slept with Tony.
Yeah.
And really, it wasn't for me. You know what? I really wasn't for him. And he dumped me when you got back. And that's what I have. So for me, that made it more stronger than just, I don't like the mob. Like, then it made sense to me why I have this thing. Because he dumped me. And he made me screw my best friend over. And if we would have stayed together, it would have been great. I wouldn't have cared as much. You know, we're in love, that's it. But he dumped me when she came back. That was for me. And then I always felt like, you know, yeah, I'm looking out for Artie, but I wish I would have had a more softer side where you would have saw a couple of episodes where, why does he love me? Oh, this is where, there she goes. That's why he's with her. Otherwise, I always felt like I kind of fought that kind of like, I don't know, that relentless nagging.
Like, yeah.
What did David say?
I wish my character would have been a little nicer.
What did he say? When you told David that, what did he say?
Oh, I said, so I made myself a backstory and that's what happened. He went, nah.
Yeah, but that makes sense to you.
In my mind.
In your mind, it doesn't have to work for anybody else. Yeah. For the actor, right? We have to make these choices for ourselves, right? And then it gives us something to root ourselves and ground ourselves.
Yeah, it gave me so much when I decided that that's what it is, because then I really didn't hate him. I was just still hurt and angry with him. It's not so much like I couldn't stand him, you know, the way I felt she was written.
Right. That makes a lot of sense. That's really cool. You know, we asked David Proval. I asked him, what was the key for you to get into Richie? What drove Richie? And he said it was his bitterness at the industry for being like overlooked for so many years.
Hey, Estelle Parsons always says, you are the character and you never go away. Whatever you want to do that's going inside you, bring it out through their words.
Yeah.
Well, and like, when you finally met Johnny, Artie Bucco, Johnny Ventimiglia, did you know John before or just you met him the first day on the set?
I never knew Johnny. But I instantly clicked with him. I loved him so much. Like, I was just like, I'm so lucky. If this works out, I can't wait to work with this guy again. He just was funny.
Yeah.
And he was
hilarious.
I like Johnny. He's such a I don't know, I find Johnny deep down inside, he's a real like sensitive, gentle person.
He's a good guy. Good
definitely,
guy.
100%.
Yeah, and he said nice things about you when he was on the show. He enjoyed working with you a lot.
I really did.
Now, you worked with Edie a lot, which we all know is a real pleasure. You worked with Jim a lot, right? Especially at the beginning. The scene where she waves you on when you're catering the party and she treats you like you're supposed to be one of her closest friends and she treats you like you're just a worker and then you give her the big, you know, touche that you banged Tony. That is a wonderful moment.
Yeah. I even felt bad doing that. I felt so bad doing that. I really did. But he's fantastic. God.
Johnny's a great actor and very physical actor and very funny. And just the two of you made a great combination, you know, as the Buccos. You know?
Yeah.
They're very, it's just, you know, that's the magic of The Sopranos, that everybody, that cast is so, everybody's like a character unto themselves. You know what I mean? That's, they're not like actors. They're just like original, unique human beings, you know what I mean? It's like I can't imagine anybody doing those roles besides the people who did it, you know?
I know, every single person.
Yeah, we've, you know, as we talk to people, we hear Tony read for, Johnny V read for Tony and David Provost read for Tony and, you know, I think Tony Sirico read for Junior and right. None of that works in my mind except for, like you said, the people got the role.
All right. Frank Vincent read for Uncle Junior.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And who did you read for?
Me or for Steve? Me? I just read for Christopher.
And you?
I read for Skip Lipari, Louis Lombardi's role.
Oh.
I read for that first. And luckily I didn't get that because, you know, once Big Pussy was gone, so was he, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and of course, so all these other movies, you've been working a real lot. The Godfather of Harlem, The Irishman, I missed you. I had a very small role in Jersey Boys. Did you enjoy working with Clint Eastwood?
Oh, my God, yeah, a lot.
Because I missed you on the set.
You know? He's such a class act. Did you guys work with him?
I worked with him and I got to work with him on another movie previously, Hereafter. So this is my second time. Great guy, yeah.
So soft-spoken and lovely. He's a lovely guy. Just a real good guy. I mean, I just feel so blessed that I got to work with all these people in my lifetime already. Like, just so blessed that I got to.
And you just worked with Tom Hardy not long ago. What's that like?
Tom Hardy's very, very, very interesting guy. He's probably the most unique of all, I think.
In what way?
He dances to the beat of his own drum, man. He's got, did you ever work with him?
No, I've never even met him. Jim worked with him on The Drop. They got
along. He loved Jim. Oh, yeah. God, he loved Jim.
Yeah.
Yeah, he talked about Jim a lot. And he's unique in a way because he's, first of all, he's not at all like, not even one character that he's ever played. Like, I can't go, oh, there I see you. He's so different from every character he's ever played. And he is extremely smart, and he has the best sense of humor. I mean, I just laughed all the time with him. And, you know, he's got a great love for music. And in a way, he's like Jim, too, with the vets. He's so into that, you know, with the vets and supporting them and all that. He's a really nice guy.
That's good. You did. And The Irishman, of course, you worked with Scorsese. Was that the first time you worked with Scorsese?
Yeah.
Did you have to read for that?
Scorsese is great, as Michael knows. Yeah,
did you have to read for that, Kathrine?
Actually, you have to say Scorsese.
Scorsese, yeah. That's
Scorsese.
True. That's the correct pronunciation.
That's the correct. You know what? I had to. Yes.
You did.
Oh my God. So I went in and I improvised. I had to improvise with the girl who was playing Joe Pesci's Bob's wife, Stephanie. Yeah. Let me tell you something. I wanted that role so bad from like the get. I was just like, I've got to get in. I want to work with Scorsese so bad. So I went back and, oh, so she said, you're going to come back again, but you're just going to come back and meet Marty. And the setup was in this hotel room. You know, they're like the little office thing there and all that. And in the same place that I auditioned, just in another room, they were renting out a hotel. Marty, I think, likes to work like that. Like, he rents out these nice, like, rooms, you know, makes them an office, an audition area. So then I went back, and I just had to sit there and talk to Marty. And I wound up sitting there for over an hour with him. And we went from espresso to a glass of Prosecco, and I felt like I was just the most down-to-earth, humble, greatest human being in this business.
Yeah, no, that's true. That's how I felt. He made me feel, I mean, because I hadn't done much, and he just made me feel like I belong there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that I was an actor. He made me feel like I was an actor and I belonged on that set with those. And they all felt, made me feel like that. But he's, you know, he's the boss on the set. And he really, I'll never forget. I'm really indebted to him for that. I'm very.
I know.
Yeah.
You know, so people don't realize how much they impact you. Well, obviously more than you impact them, because they give you a break and they believe in you. And you had the same experience I had. I had it later on. I mean, I worked with Bob at a young age, and then I worked with him again on the Mayoff thing. And then me and you, we were in that Sammy the Bull thing, and Bob was involved with that. So
he was the EP, executive producer. We did that after the pilot, before the show got picked up. Actually, the Sopranos got picked up while we were shooting Witness to the Mob.
Right.
Because it was Christmas.
So, I mean, I worked with Bob a couple of times, and I feel like I know Bob enough, you know. But to be in a scene, it was very surreal to me to be in that car. That car, you know how Marty works. Everything's very detailed. He takes a long time. So that car was weeks. Being in that car was like a couple of weeks doing that, stopping off. It was over, you know, course of a couple of weeks. And still today, like, I look and I remember there was one scene, all those scenes just in the car, like, there was so much quiet time because we were isolated. It was beautiful because we were isolated on a highway up in Nyack. And on a real highway, we were just me, Bob, Stephanie, and Pesci, and Scorsese. So it was such this intimate, and then in nature, I was listening to these birds one day, and we were all just waiting for tweaking, and I just looked over, and I'm just like, how the fuck did I get here? Why am I so lucky? Like, I felt so humble and blessed. And then when we did the scene where they were all in the scene, I mean, it was Pacino, De Niro, Pesci, Scorsese, Leo came to set that day, DiCaprio, Ray Romano, Bobby Cannavale. I mean, every single person that was in the movie was in this one scene at this, when De Niro's character gets awarded. And I just looked around. Stevie Van Zandt was there singing.
All right.
And I remember looking around going, this is, like, I'm so blessed. Like, this is the most beautiful thing ever. When will I ever get this again? These iconic Last of the Mohegans all in one shot.
Absolutely.
And like, you did it too. You were on set with all of them and that.
Yeah. It's pretty surreal when you're with, you know, when you're with people who really meant, you know, mean a lot to you as an actor. You know, these are like your heroes, and suddenly you're in the moment, in the scene with them. It's pretty cool. And he makes that magic happen, Marty. He really, it's like effortless. Like, it just, you don't really, it's almost like you don't have to work. It's just, it just happens. You know, he makes that environment.
A complete trust.
Yeah.
But I want to ask you, do you recognize that moment more now than when you were in it? Do you appreciate it more now and think about it now in a more, you know, because when you're in it, you know, it's like when I did A Bronx Tale, I knew it, but first of all, I was very young. I didn't realize what was happening, but I knew what was happening. But I mean, now when I think about it, like, I want to go back and know what I know now and be in it.
Yeah. No, I understand that. You know, the part of it's that you don't know, A, is the scene going to stay in the movie? Is it going to get cut out? Is it going to get cut and you're hardly in it? You know, is the movie going to bomb, come and go? You know, you never know, right? So then the movie comes out. The movie's a smash.
Wow.
Smash hit. And the scenes are both there, and they're kind of right in the middle of the movie, and they're important scenes. And then you kind of realize, oh, wow. And then, you know, those movies, I'm sure it'll be the same with The Irishman. It's the same with The Sopranos. Their kind of legend grew over time. Like, Goodfellas, like, became, over the years, a bigger and bigger movie in a weird way, like The Godfather, like The Sopranos.
Well, yeah. Listen, I felt that way when I would shoot a scene with Jim, like up at the lake house, me, Jim, Edie, Aida. I felt that way.
Yes.
Even late into the series, like, hey, what am I doing here? And now I think back, those were incredible times. And I enjoyed it, but probably, like you're saying, not as much as I should have. I enjoy it now, thinking about these scenes we all had, and we were all together, and, you know, back then. And even the Emmys and the SAG Awards, and we would have these incredible premieres and parties and fun. And, you know, one more time, I'd like to, we're all back together, you know, one more time.
We did enjoy it, though. It's not like we didn't. I mean, come on.
I know me and Johnny Weed did.
Yeah. We had a lot. We all did pretty well. We all had fun.
I used to say, the West Wing ain't doing what we're doing.
No. No, they weren't.
All right, what's up next? I see your beautiful artwork in the back.
My artwork?
I've been seeing your paintings on Instagram. I think I saw one. Did you do one of the Virgin Mary?
I did like a sort of a pop one of the Virgin Mary.
Yeah, I liked that a lot. I thought that was really cool.
Thank you.
And
I just did a whole series of these. I call them the usual suspects.
The portraits with kind of the kind of smear faces.
Yeah,
I saw those too. Those are cool.
Thank you. Really nice.
Really.
When did you start painting? Was that before acting or recent?
No, I started. Yeah, way before. I'm painting since my early twenties. But then I put it down, and then I started again. Maybe 10 years.
Isn't your daughter an artist?
No, my daughter's a photographer.
Oh, photographer, that's right.
Yeah.
Just think, Kathrine, if you would have got that gig for En Vogue, we wouldn't be talking right now. I had a whole different career.
Yeah.
Well, now, listen, it's absolutely great talking to you. I couldn't thank you enough for doing this. Fans are going to be so happy listening and seeing you. You look great. And be safe out there.
Thanks. Thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you for doing this.
Thank you. And I love my bows.
All right. Good. Enjoy.
You know what? I didn't know how to set it up. I was getting nervous. I was going to put them on, but I can't wait. I mean, I ride my bike in the park. Like, I do like 8 miles. I will be wearing those.
Beautiful. Excellent. Thank you, really.
Thanks,
Kathrine.
All the best
to you and your family. Thank you.
All right.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you. All right, Kathrine Narducci.
She's great. She's got great stories. That's a hell of a story. You just don't ever know. She goes on the audition, and she's had an incredible career. All right, pal. 2 seasons down, 5 more to go. Here we are, season 3, episode 1.
I can't believe it. Seems like yesterday we just started.
See, you're being sarcastic again.
Wow, what are you talking about? What's sarcastic? But, I said it seems like yesterday.
To me, it flew by. It's been, 5 months? Four or five months?
It's been four or five months.
And I got to show you something. I want to show you something. We have some of the best fans, and I want to show you this. Because we have some great fans, and they've been, if you could see this, right?
What is it?
It's artwork. That's me, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. And now, this is you.
Yeah, that's great.
Now, you could tell it's me. This guy gave you a receding hairline. Are you going bald, Michael?
I am. I guess so, according to him.
Are you going bald? I mean, it's not to be ashamed of, because according to this gentleman, you know, of course, me, I'm fat. And all the pictures of me, and we've got a lot of fan art. and I appreciate it, and I welcome fan art. I don't know how you feel about it. They could draw
I don't welcome it.
Okay, I do.
I don't
welcome the fan art, and some of it has been great. And, you know, of course, all the pictures, I kind of basically the same dark hair, fat face, you know, so I basically look the same, scars. This particular gentleman gave you a little bit of a receding hairline.
I'm getting old, Steve. I'm not getting any younger, that's for sure.
Listen, they have, you know, weaves, toupees, hair transplants. I'll lend you some of mine if you need be.
I don't know. I didn't realize I did need that, but according to this guy, I do. I want to bring up the we have merchandise for sale. You know, you can go on our website, talkingsopranos.com or the YouTube. You're selling limited edition shirts with your name in bigger print than any other thing on the t-shirt. Now, I noticed it's a dollar cheaper than the real shirt and it's limited edition. Is that so you'll sell out so you could say that you sold them out?
But wait a minute. First of all, I don't know why you're bringing this up. I'm just saying, well, I'm selling.
It's been on my mind.
But
it's
we're
been
partners.
On my mind. I know, we're but partners. Is it a ploy so it sells out and you could say that?
I just think it's in such high demand that we can't keep them on the shelves.
I've gotten some complaints about it from TOPA, you know, the Typesetter and Offset Printer Association of America, who feels it gives them a bad name because there's no symmetry to it. But that's a whole other story.
Listen, they're flying off the shelves at any price.
Yeah.
So I don't know why this is such a... Give me a little sliver of the pie, Michael. That's all I ask.
I work hard. You
just
got it. We'll give you a sliver
of the pie.
I also, you know what I'd like to do today, if you're up for it, I'd like to read the credits now because I have a feeling a lot of our fans don't listen to the credits. And I think that's unfair and wrong.
Okay, but you know, we did a few episodes back talk about credits on a TV show and movie.
Exactly.
And people liked it very much.
They liked it, but I don't think they're listening to the credits.
Right.
I think they turn off. We have important people that need to be acknowledged.
All right, let's do it.
All right.
I like it.
All right, let's go.
You gonna read them off?
Yeah, I mean, you start this one if you want, or I could just go to the names. Let's do that.
Let's go. Let's give the credits. Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman. Producer is Andy Verderon.
Andy's the guy that I'm, you know, Steve and I are always asking for help during the course of the podcast. That's Andy. We call him, he's like the fifth soprano. If there were
four. The man. He's the man.
That doesn't make sense. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amatin. You can hear more of Elijah's music and also the band Zopa, which Elijah and I are in together. You can click on the links at TalkingSopranos.com. Our production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production. Now, we haven't started yet, so don't go off the air, folks. Stay with us. We're just doing the credits up front.
You're throwing the whole thing out of whack. It's all upside down. The universe. It's the bizarro world.
I think it's time to do that. We need that here on this show.
The bizarro world. It's like we're going to do everything from the backwards forward now. Let's start with the last scene of the show.
Let's start with the last scene of the show. Go back. They did that on Seinfeld.
They did
that episode in India. They did it in reverse, which was based on Betrayal, which is a play by Harold Pinter that goes in reverse. And that's what they based that on.
That was with Peterman out there and all that. Yeah. That was a good one. So I got to tell you, I'm very happy to be starting. We got some great guests coming up. Season 3, it's going to be great. Season 3 was a great Soprano season.
Yeah, there's some classics.
They're all great, but really good stuff.
Employee of the Month, Pine Barrens, those are two really. University, that's another episode from season 3. Those are three classic Soprano episodes.
There's some really, really good stuff. And I was thinking, you know, I don't know what kind of music you listen to. I don't know if we listen. You listen to a lot of music, but we probably listen. We listen to different stuff, I would assume.
Well, I mean, I'm sure there's crossover. Well, Van Morrison, you love
Van Morrison. I love Van Morrison.
So do I. Van Morrison's Billy one of my Joel. Favorites.
Billy Joel.
Billy Joel, I love. Yeah.
You like Leonard Cohen? I'm a big Leonard Cohen.
Leonard Cohen? I love Leonard Cohen. Yeah. He's great.
Who else? I, Springsteen. I like the old stuff.
Yeah, I like Springsteen.
I mean, you know, and listen, and it's not that I think these bands that I don't listen to or these singers are bad by any means. It's just, you know, we all have our
thing. Out of all the ones you mentioned, Van Morrison is stands out to me. Astral Weeks, I think, is just one of the greatest albums ever made in rock.
And that great scene where Tony Soprano kills Tony Blundetto. Glad Tidings is playing. It's a classic.
Glad Tidings. And Comfortably Numb is playing when Christopher meets his demise.
Greetings, you know, from New York. Glad Tidings from New York. My first concert that I saw, Grateful Dead. I was 16 years old.
Were you a deadhead?
No.
You became a deadhead?
A deadhead. Yeah. Do I look like a deadhead?
I don't know.
No, I
think we should say that you're a deadhead. That should be a new T-shirt. We'll do the Steve Schirripa deadhead Sopranos T-shirt.
There's guys in the neighborhood. They had an extra ticket. I think it had gotten rained out. It was at Roosevelt Stadium. You ever go to Roosevelt Stadium? You're too young. It was in Jersey City.
I did. I saw a soccer game there, like New York Cosmos. I think they played there before they went to Giant Stadium.
It was an old baseball stadium. Yeah, and I saw the Dead. I saw Emerson, Lake and Palmer there, Doobie Brothers, Chicago, you know.
The Grateful Dead, I was driving in it with my grandfather. He was probably like in his late 70s. He was a guy he grew up in Manhattan, like on the dead end kids. Like he was like that. You know, he grew up kind of like that way. Old New York dude. And we were driving in a car, and there was a car in front of us, a bumper sticker, a Grateful Dead bumper sticker, and he just went, "Grateful Dead." What the hell is that? I said, "Oh, they're a rock band." Grateful Dead? They're grateful because they're dead? I don't understand. He just, it's just a name. It's a name, Grant. That's a name? It just didn't compute the idea.
Your grandfather sounds a little like Meg Cassara.
That's how he said. No, Ben had a much more theatrical voice. My grandfather sounded more like that. He was more of a...
Grateful Dead, who I like. You know, I like. I don't love.
I grew to like them. I never liked them till I got older for some reason.
You know, I'm reading a book now about the drummer. It's got a good book out. I'm watching.
Which
I watched
one? Mickey Hart? Was he the
No, drummer? The other guy. Mickey Hart was one. The other guy, Bill...
They had two drummers. They would have two sets on stage and play. Yeah,
yeah. Bill Kurtzman. Or I forget. I don't know.
Oh, Bill Kurtzman. Yeah, I think that's his name.
I'm reading his book. And then I watched two episodes of Amazon. There's a six-part Grateful Dead documentary. And I watched a couple. It's really good. You know, yeah. Listen, I'm a huge Allman Brothers fan. Big Allman Brothers fan.
My son David is as well.
Big Allman Brothers. Big Paul Simon.
Love Paul Simon, yeah.
Big Paul Simon. I happen to be, you know, sometimes there's a moment you're watching something and you go, I can't believe I'm seeing this. This is so fucking good. You never want it to end. You know what I mean? Yeah, you ever, you know, like, and I saw Paul Simon at the Beacon and Art Garfunkel came out like a surprise.
Wow.
And they sang, it was just so good. And another time, I don't know if you remember when we were in Chicago, it was me, you, Jim, and Stevie Van Zandt. And we went to Buddy Guy's. We were doing an appearance out there at a casino.
Yes, of course.
The four of us. And we went to Buddy Guy's and we were, come on, Stevie. You know, we were drunk. Certainly the three of us were. Stevie had a couple drinks in him. He's not a big drinker, right? But we were going, come on, get up and play, get up and play, get up and play. And he did. Do you remember how fucking that was one of the moments I said, I can't believe I'm saying this.
Yeah, he got up and played with the band. He didn't want to steal their thunder.
Yeah.
He didn't want to make it all about him because the band was great and he was being very humble about it. And the audience and the band just were relentless. And finally he got up and he ripped.
Oh, It was so great. He huddled them all together. I mean, out of nowhere, we just walked into place, you know, and he huddled everyone together, the band, he talked to them. It was so good. So good, you know. But you listen, you're a punk guy. You like punk.
I like a lot of music. I mean, I big time like the New York punk scene, CBGB scene, like all those, the Ramones and Television and Patti Smith and Lou Reed. Lou Reed was my, you know, biggest musical hero. I mean,
you like the New York Dolls?
Big time New York Dolls, Johnny Thunders and David Johansen. Martin Scorsese is making a movie about David Johansen.
Oh, really?
A documentary. Actually, last year, David Johansen did a residency at the Carlisle Hotel, and I went to see it, and I was sitting at the bar next to my friend Jesse Mallon, who is a great musician, has a great album out called Sunset Kids, and Marty was sitting at the table right in front of us, and after the show, we kind of hung out, and we were talking to him, and David came out and sat, and the four of us were chatting with the... and it was a great New York night. I didn't know at the time, but he was planning on doing this documentary about David Johansen.
Did you know David Johansen before that night?
I had met him a few times, yeah.
Nice guy?
He's great. I mean, he sounds incredible still. He is in good shape, and he's, you know, he is a New York institution without a doubt. Buster Poindexter is his alias. Yeah.
And he's done some acting. Funny. He's done some acting.
He was in Scrooged. He had a big part in that movie, actually. Yeah, he's done quite a bit of acting, actually. But
you know,
my band played on a bill. What we did a benefit when after Don Hill died. Don Hill owned a great rock club in New York. In the memorial concert, my band played, and David Johansen performed that night.
I don't think I was. I didn't see David Johansen. I remember seeing your band there. I think.
At the Don Hill Memorial. No, this was at Irving Plaza. It was a memorial for Don Hill's.
Because Don Hill's was on Spring and...
Spring and that Renwick, that little street near Hudson, between Hudson and Greenwich.
Which I think it's still there. It's just empty, you know. It's just that little short building there, you know. He was a nice guy, Don Hill.
He was a great guy.
Yes, he was a nice guy.
An important part of the nightlife of New York City. Yeah.
You know. You know, so, you know, I got an eclectic taste, I guess. But, you know, I'm an older guy, so I like that kind of stuff. Early on, I saw, I'm older than you, the disco era, you know, the Tramps, Evelyn Champagne King, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. They all played in the clubs back in the 70s.
All right.
You know, you would see them like on a Friday or Saturday night, you know, like, you know, that kind of scene. And then, of course, when I got to Vegas, you know, I saw Sinatra like 20 times. I saw Sammy Davis Jr.
Must have been great. How was Sammy Davis Jr.? He was a showman.
It was okay. It was about half full. It was at Caesar's Palace.
Why?
I don't know. Byron Allen opened for him. Remember Byron Allen, who now owns...
He's a billionaire now.
He's a billionaire. He was like an 18, 19-year-old comic. He got me tickets. I was a bouncer at Paul Anka's club, Jubilation at the time. And, you know, he came into the club. He invited me to the show. I don't know why. He did not pack him in, Sammy Davis. It was a downtime, maybe 81 or 82.
It might have been after he joined the Church of Satan. Maybe that might have turned some people off for a while.
You know, I don't know. You know, it was a good show.
Did you know that he joined?
I knew something about that. Yeah. That's when he was estranged from Sinatra. But I thought that was early on.
That didn't go down well with Frank. Worship.
Well, you know, I saw Sinatra in the early 80s. And then I saw him towards the end, you know, towards when he was ending performing. Obviously different, but still great. I saw and I knew Liberace. Did I ever tell you that?
Yes, I know you knew Liberace.
Liberace.
He was beloved in Vegas, right?
Everybody beloved guy, generous, nice guy. And he, you know, he would come in for dinner. It was a restaurant. And he would come in and I was there with the tuxedo. And I Mr. Liberace, but call me Lee. I said, well, I'm Steve. So whenever I saw him, I would go, hello, Lee. And he would go, hi, Steve. How's that? That's my Liberace impression.
That's pretty good, Steve.
Pretty good.
You don't do a lot of impressions. That's a good one.
Hey, Lee, how you doing? Hi, Steve. That's what he would say. He was a very sweet guy.
What, did you ever see Louis Prima?
No, that was before. He passed away before I got there.
I saw Keeley Smith. I met Keeley a few times. Yeah.
Yeah. I saw Keeley at the DI with Sam Butera, who worked for me a few times, sax player. Yes. Yeah, Sam was great. One of the best shows I've ever seen, ever, Johnny Mathis. Johnny Mathis puts on a great show. He's still performing, and I'm telling you, he's great.
Tom Jones.
Great. We saw Tom Jones.
That was a great show. We were all there in Vegas, all the Sopranos. He invited us.
Ten of us.
He took us in his dressing room. That was great. And a really good show.
That's when we talked about Sirico and him were banging the same girl at one point.
Yeah, not at the same time. He made a point of saying that.
But I saw Frank Sinatra Jr. at the MGM. I was with Stevie Van Zandt, Vinny Pastore. I was still living in Vegas. We went to Nobu. We went to the show. They introduced Vinny Pastore. They introduced Stevie Van Zandt. I'm at the table sitting with them. He don't introduce me from the audience. Like a fucking big fuck you he gave me. Like a big double
maybe
fuck.
Maybe he didn't see you, though.
He saw me. Stop with that. Now, you always say, why? Like I'm starting in. The guy dissed me. Now we
why
go.
Why would he diss you?
I have no idea why he did that. If he was alive, I would ask him. We go backstage. And he didn't really talk to us. We stood there. We had a drink. He was wearing a members-only jacket. He had the bodyguards like his father, Merrill, who I love, Merrill Kellum. And he didn't really talk to us. I didn't quite understand it.
Wow. I saw Johnny Cash play at a little club in New York. It was called Fez. It was down in the basement of, well, it was Time Cafe. Now it's, I don't know what it is now, but on Great Jones Street in Lafayette. And it was right when that album came out on American Records that Rick Rubin produced.
One of his last thing.
It was a small club. It was him and his wife, June Carter Cash, and it was tremendous. He was really great.
I saw him with the Highwaymen, Willie Nelson, Chris Christopherson, Waylon Jennings, and Johnny Cash. And he would play Vegas quite a bit. And Willie had a road manager named Purdy. And we were friends. We became friends. So me and Laura, my wife, would go a lot to see them. Willie alone, we're big Willie Nelson fans. See Willie alone and the Highwaymen. They had put this all-star group together and they traveled the country. Fantastic. And we met Johnny Cash and Chris Christopherson and that was great. I mean, really something. Van Morrison I saw with Dylan. Went up to Reno and went to L.A., UCLA. And then Van Morrison played Vegas alone. And I think it was Mandalay Bay. And then out of nowhere, they announced a concert in the lounge, like at 4 in the afternoon. He just decided he wanted to play. And at the time, it was like $200 a ticket. It was like 200 people there. And he just was up there, and it was unbelievable. I mean, that's another one of those things. I said, I can't believe I'm seeing this, you know?
I was at Live Aid, 1985 in Philadelphia. That was a big experience.
And who was that, Queen? Who was that?
Queen was in England. No, in the U.S., in Philadelphia, it was... God, they, you know, Santana, Pretenders, Madonna, Rod Stewart, Tom Petty, Neil Young, The Cars.
Wow.
Zeppelin. Wow. Led Zeppelin. Well, John Bonham was dead. So Phil Collins actually played with Led Zeppelin and he didn't know the song. And they play the song Rock and Roll. And Phil Collins doesn't know what he's doing. And you could see Jimmy Page getting really pissed off.
Wow.
He's basically fucking it up. But it was a thrill to see him. Mick Jagger and Tina Turner performed together. Keith Richards and Ronnie Wood played with Bob Dylan. It was an experience.
I mean, but that's one. Well, that's one of those.
9 a.m. to like midnight all day.
I mean, that's one of those things where you go, man, I can't believe this. I mean, that's something you'll never forget the rest of your life, you know?
Was the year later at the Amnesty concert that Stevie Van Zandt played, Little Steven, at Giant Stadium. But I was with Fernando, my buddy, and we were up front, Giant Stadium. Bill Graham was really hot. Bill Graham, if you remember in Apocalypse Now, he has a scene when he brings the Playboy bunnies to the stage. He's promoting that. Well, Bill Graham owned the Fillmore West.
He's a big legend. Fillmore East.
So he's on stage with fire hoses wetting us all down because it was so hot. I mean, it was ridiculously hot. And at some point, I think it was Joni Mitchell or Joan Baez. Joan Baez was on stage doing an acoustic number, and a lot of the young people didn't know who she was. Somebody threw a beer can at Joan Baez. Bill Graham, who at the time had to be in his 50s or 60s, climbed off the stage into the audience and started beating the shit out of the guy.
You saw that?
I was almost next to the guy.
Oh, man.
He climbed into the fucking crowd and started punching the shit out of
him. Good for him. Good for him.
Never forget it. It was insane.
Wow. What an asshole. What an asshole to throw the fucking can at Joan Baez. I mean,
Miles Davis played at that show. I saw Miles Davis play.
That's a topper of all toppers. Yeah. I saw Rodney, I think I've told you this, open for Frankie Valli.
Rodney Dangerfield? Season.
Dangerfield was the opening act for Frankie Valli of Four Seasons at the Aladdin Hotel.
And you saw him naked, right? Rodney Dangerfield?
I saw Rodney Dangerfield. No, I saw his balls, not naked. He had a robe on.
Oh, that's right.
Come on. What do you think? We ran around naked, me and Rodney. I saw his balls. You could not see them.
That's pretty close.
Well, listen, there's a singer who I'm a huge fan of, Michael Franks. You familiar with Michael Franks?
No.
The jazz singer. And I'm a big fan. I have been for many, many years. It's not for everybody. And he would do a lot of these smooth jazz concerts. I go to this concert. Vegas used to have a lot of these. Remember the smooth jazz, Boney James and Kenny G before he got big. And, you know, these kind of Spyro Gyra, you know. And so Michael Franks is coming on, and they have an opening act, a comic, a terrible comic named David Iannacci. He used to work for me. He's terrible, okay? And it's in the summer. It's 105 or hotter. He comes out with a tuxedo on. People are in the grass. He comes out with a tuxedo on. You know, he's an old shtick comic, you know? So he's doing his act. He is dying 1,000 deaths. Not even crickets. Any sound would have been great. The guy's doing his shtick. He's got a tuxedo on. He's out of place. His closing bit, he does a chicken impression. All right? Do you hear me?
Yeah, chicken impression.
I didn't know if you were fucking alive. I thought you started meditating on me. All right. So he does a chicken impression, and he puts on big chicken feet, takes off the tux, like rip away, puts on the chicken feet. He's got two sunny side eggs on his fucking chest. He puts a tail on, and he's walking around fucking flapping like a chicken. I kid you not. There's 1,000 people there. Not a laugh, not a sound. Kind of like what you're doing to me now. And then when it's over, you see the guy, no applause, no nothing. Good night, folks. He's pushing his trunk of props up a hill. He's still in the chicken outfit. It was That's demoralizing, terrible. So terrible. He's pushing it up a hill, sweating. You see the fucking tail. He still got the chicken feet on.
But did that act work before? I mean, were there times when that got over and he got laughs?
Yeah, well, the act, he's in a review shows. He gets laughs. You know, it's a review show. You're doing 10 minutes. I mean, he should have never been booked there. You know, I mean, it was just horrifying. You know, just and a poor choice by him, you know.
Terrible.
But I mean, I've seen a lot of acts there, you know, Tito Puente, Gypsy Kings, Dave Matthews, I'm a big fan of, you know, I still got an iPod. You know, I don't have a, you know, this is
That's my an iPhone.
Isn't no, it? It's an iPod. This is an iPod. And this is a phone. This is a phone iPod. So I have all my stuff on my iPod. I like Hawaiian music. I like Los Lobos.
They're not Hawaiian.
No.
They're Mexican.
That's two different thoughts. I like Los Lobos.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I get you. It is definitely a takeoff. Ruggerio, Angelo Ruggerio, maybe it has something to do with because he was on the wiretaps big time in the Gotti crew. He was instrumental in them putting a case together against John Gotti, I think.
And they bugged his home, I believe.
Yeah, and he talked a lot. That was kind of the joke about him, that he was a big talker. I think Vinny Pastore played Angelo Ruggerio in Gotti, the HBO, with Armando Sante, if I'm not mistaken. I think that...
Now, this episode, it's you know, they premiered them together. They were shot out of sequence. Season 3, episode 2 was actually shot first. I was in Vancouver doing C-Spot Run, and the movie wasn't over yet, and I had to fly myself back. I mean, I got that call. It was the only time in my entire life I went to a movie theater by myself. I was in Vancouver. I had a day off from shooting the movie. I had been there for 2 months. My agent calls on the cell phone. Yeah, he said, Sopranos won't budge. You got to work, you know, Monday, say.
Wow.
I'm in full panic mode. You know, I just became a series regular. I have my own dime. I fly back from Vancouver to New York, shoot. I think it was a funeral parlor scene, Livia's funeral, blah, blah, blah. And then I had to fly back to Vancouver, finish the movie, and come back. So it was shot out of sequence. It premiered.
Well, everything got a little bit screwed up, you know, production wise, obviously, because Nancy passed away, which nobody knew was going to happen. And
Nancy passed away.
Yeah.
Even Aida Totoro, you know, when you see her in episode 12 after she, Janice kills Richie Aprile, that was it for Aida Totoro.
When she goes off on the bus back to Seattle, that was
she
that.
Was done. She was done. Yeah. You know, not to say they may not bring her back here and there, but basically she was done. But once Nancy passed away, she came back on as a series regular again.
So they broadcast the first two episodes of the season together on the same Sunday night. That's how they showed it in the premiere. When we saw the premiere, I guess it was maybe Radio City or the Ziegfeld in New York. They showed them back to back. Because this first episode is a weird one. It's definitely not the usual Sopranos episode. There's a lot of FBI stuff. There's not a ton of, you know, characters, you know, who do a lot outside of Tony and the feds really here, and Carmela to some extent. But it's a strange episode.
Well, what helped it certainly, and I think it was David Chase's wonderful wife, Denise, gave the suggestion. I was told, I guess we can ask David, about putting the Peter Gunn, mixing the Peter Gunn tune with the Sting tune.
With Every Breath You Take by the Police. That was Denise Chase's idea. I've heard that as well. And that she thought those two songs would somehow work together.
Well, it did work together.
And they do work together really well. And Peter Gunn was Henry Mancini. And that was a TV show about a private eye, wasn't it? Or a spy?
Great. One of the better TV theme songs ever.
A great TV theme. And Every Breath You Take, which is about stalking, it seems, about somebody who's just, you know.
Well, that's what it is.
And watching. And so those, and the bass line, the beat of the song and the bass line, it went together very smoothly. And it was a stroke of genius on Denise.
And it was Alan Coulter directed it. David Chase wrote it. And here we go. We're at the Soprano house. Here comes Tony, walks down the driveway, picks up the paper. The headline, Mob Competition for Garbage Contracts Heats Up. Now, you know, Jim, when he used to do these walk down the driveways, you know, they would shoot a whole bunch of them, you know. They would shoot a whole bunch of them different ways. Yeah. I mean, I'm not saying to use in different episodes, but they would do a whole bunch of different ways. This one, he's kind of out of it, if you notice.
He's out of it, but the shot is very cinematic. I mean, it looks like the opening of a season, the way Alan Coulter.
Well, you know what I mean? He's not spry. Looks like he just really woke up out of bed. It's a new season. Jim is in pretty good shape here. A little thinner in this season. Different season. He would go on diets in between seasons.
Did he?
And we're like, oh, sure. Sure. Sometimes you see him a little heavier. There was one season he was actually a fairly thin Tony Soprano.
Season one, he was.
But even after that, you know, Jim would.
I never noticed that. That's a good thing. You know, it says on the newspaper, violence feared, referring to the mob, you know, the garbage trucks and the mob stuff. But in actuality, there's no threat of that throughout this episode, of the violence or some kind of
mob war. You don't see any of that.
You don't see any of that there. It also says the article that he's looking at is written by Bob Shaw. Bob Shaw was our production designer. That's a little inside.
And I think he either won or was nominated for an Academy Award, I think, for The Irishman.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he's a huge thing.
He's really, really good.
And a good guy, and huge, huge stuff he's done after The Sopranos, you know?
Episode has very weird, in certain scenes, especially when they're going from an FBI scene to back to Tony or back to The Sopranos, really weird quiet fade to blacks.
Yeah.
Which I've never quite seen in the show.
No, it's the only time I think ever.
Yeah.
It's almost like there was commercial breaks, right?
Very strange.
Long. Very they strange. Were longer than usual.
Longer than usual. Oddly quiet. There's not like transition music or anything. Yeah. They stood out as very, very, very strange. And
I noticed that. So they're the FBI officers. The agents are listening to the tapes with Big Pussy in the meeting room. They know that he's now dead. They know that Pussy is dead. They discuss the RICO Act. They're going to bug the Soprano house.
And they're listening to some recordings. They're listening to him, you know, about the Matt, you know, and Pussy's trying to lead him down the Matt Bevilacqua case, trying to get him to say, you know, incriminate himself. But Tony really gives them nothing. You know, he doesn't say much incriminating stuff at all. You think that's because he was suspecting Pussy?
He's been bugged for 4 years. They got nothing. So he's just smart and being careful, not careless, as so many people are. You know, I was on a wiretap with a bookmaker in Vegas years ago. You know, and I guess legally they have to send you a letter. And I got a letter from the FBI saying that I had been on a wiretap. His phone was tapped, and I talked to him. It was a guy that, you know, we would just hang out. I wasn't gambling. You know, we were friends, and I would say, hey, you know, he would call. I would call, hey, you going out tonight? Where you going? All right, catch up to you later. And I was on a wiretap. I got a letter in the mail.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't know that, man.
Yeah. I mean, it was very innocent. Dominic Spinelli, his name was. They call him Little Dicky. A very generous guy. Throw hundreds around all over town. When he was doing good, the whole town was doing good. Big, big stack of money. Very generous. I remember coming back to New York. He said, there's 4 play tickets waiting for you. Go take your, you know, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Go take your girl. I think he's still alive. I haven't talked to him in years. Dominic Spinelli. And he was on
the
way.
Did they put him in jail?
I think he did time, but not for that. I think he did some time at one point. But he was a bookmaker and big, big, big gambler. Big crap shooter, big. And then he would come out and he would say, I got a bunch of money. I want to come out, throw it around. And he would go to the clubs. They knew him in all the casinos. And, you know?
Wow.
That was his thing. Federal the judge's office. This is a sneak and peek warrant. Cubitoso, yes, Your Honor, the listening device will be fabricated and will re-enter to install. They could only bug the basement, I guess.
They want, yeah, well, the judge wants them to be specific. They don't, they're not allowed to just go ransacking through the house. And they all, and they have that 40-second rule, I guess. They can only
40-second to tape and then 2 minutes off. It's really strange thinking if someone was listening to every mundane little shit that you talk about.
And mundane is what we hear. You know, the coffee maker's got to be plugged in. He's talking about that. I mean, the one thing it does, I mean, I'm sure a lot of these techniques that are shown here by the FBI are real and were done, you know, doing research and talking to people that had inside knowledge. But what it does is really show kind of the boredom of it, you know, like the long, so much of it must just be waiting around. And like you just said, listening to the mundane stuff, most of it is just boring daily, you know, and it's a grind basically is what we see here.
Absolutely. So you got the FBI listening in. Then at some point, when there's an indictment, they go to the attorney, and that's where Uncle Junior's attorney, Melvoin, says he wants wiretap experts. Then they're going to listen.
Right. Right.
And, you know, and on and on and on. It's fucking brutal. But this was 20 years ago. I would imagine the FBI's technology is way better. But it just goes to show you the lengths they go to, breaking in, wired. You know, your house might be wired right now.
Yeah. Why would that be?
I don't know. Maybe you got some going on.
I have no shit going on.
I'm just saying, Big Brother is watching all of us every moment. The other day, I was talking to somebody about a concealed weapons license. Talking to an ex-cop friend of mine.
And on the phone?
On the phone. Next thing I know, and I'm not lying, on my computer, there's like spam about getting a gun license. Swear to God. Coincidence? Maybe.
From your phone to your computer?
I'm talking on my house phone. I still have a house phone here and in New York. I'm talking to them. Does so-and-so have a concealed weapons license? Yeah, blah, 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 blah. I hang up. I don't know. Hours later, there's something about having a weapons license in my spam thing.
Is your phone connected to your computer? Oh, it's the same server.
Same server.
Oh, that's
Big Brother is watching every moment. Right now.
No, they're not watching. It's automatic. It's artificial intelligence. Nobody's watching that shit. It's just automatically hitting some algorithm and putting it up. They're just trying to sell you shit.
Well, there's one thing if you're on the computer and you, you know, look up socks and then suddenly you get all kinds of ads for socks. I get that. But I'm talking, you know, on a house, on a phone, man, you know.
Man, that's pretty weird.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Okay, the agents are in the meeting. We watch Tony's house. Tony leaves. Furio's driving. He talks to the agents. I'm going to go get some gas. I'm going down. I'll save you gas. Going down to the stationery store, and he laughs at them. They're staking out the house, okay? FBI office. They're gonna know everyone's schedule. In order to do this, the maid is gone on Tuesdays. We've got to put, you know, an FBI agent on Carmella, on the kids, on Tony, on the maid.
Yeah, what do they call him? Baby Bing, Princess Bing. Derbingle, which is a reference to Bing Crosby. Bing Crosby was called Derbingle sometimes. Did you know that?
No.
Yeah, that's
what I thought it was about the Bada Bing.
It's about the Bada Bing, but they call him Derbingle, D-E-R, the German.
Okay.
Derbingle was a reference to Bing Crosby.
So they know everybody's schedule. They're not taking any chances, even though Meadows up at Columbia. It's 45 minutes away. Here comes Tony, gets the paper. AJ leaves with his friends. They're following Meadow up at school.
This was one of those weird fades, right, going from the feds to Tony getting the paper. Another one of those weird fade to blocks, quiet ones. Very strange.
Tony singing Dirty Work, another one of my favorite bands. Great concert. Steely
I've never
Dan.
Seen Steely Dan.
Great.
Well, we were together at the Jazz Foundation benefit, and
Donald Fagen.
Donald Fagen played. He did Hesitation what's that called? Hesitation Blues or Hesitation Waltz by Louis Armstrong?
Just, it's so good. That's one of those, thank you for involving me in the Jazz Foundation, A Great Night in Harlem. That's where you see some musicians and you go, shit, I'm so glad I'm sitting here watching
this.
Yeah,
oh yeah. Jimmy Scott, I saw.
Just right great there. Stuff.
Highlight.
Carmela drives a tennis lesson. The agents are in position. Peter Gunn, the music's playing, Every Breath You Take. Tony meets the crew at the pork store. AJ's Baby Bing. FBI's got everybody covered, right? Patsy arrives at the pork store. He's got the soup bag. Silvio, Hesh, Christopher, Gigi, they're all having lunch. Skip is outside watching. Patsy says the coat shouldn't have torn like that. So the mink coat, the fur coat that Tony got Carmella, it tore.
It's not great quality, I guess. Those things should not. Or yeah. Maybe they was having rough sex, I guess. I don't know. We see
I
them.
I don't know.
Start to fool around, no?
Maybe. The pork store. Tony arrives, the crew, they're eating lunch.
A great Paulie Walnuts monologue here about cleanliness and germs. And that's a classic Paulie Walnuts diatribe about hygiene.
This is how he really feels in real life, you know?
One of the first people I ever saw have hand sanitizer, like, in his pocket. Like, This is a while ago, 20 years
20
ago.
20 years ago.
Was not a popular thing then, but he had it.
And they know that he's a germaphobe, Tony. And it's a very funny, and he's great. It's a great speech, washing the hands, the urinals, the men's room. You can eat maple walnut ice cream. There are exceptions off a woman's toilet or a bathroom.
I guess I made me think of the scene in Italy, in Naples, when he won't go to the bathroom because it was, you know, not clean, which I found to be not accurate. I said that before. I found it to be very
Soprano house. The agents, they disable the phone lines. They gain access to the house. The FBI's in a cherry picker. They shut the alarm off. You know, you don't think about this stuff. It's amazing what they can do.
They can do whatever they want, basically, right? If they have a warrant, they're posing as, you know, electric and gas guys and phone guys. And
even though you know it happens, when you see it, it's pretty amazing. Right. You know, it's like, you know.
He says, pick it, Wilson, which is a reference.
Yeah, pick it, Wilson. Very funny. The crew, they're eating lunch. Tony says to Patsy, played by Dan Grimaldi, you're not hungry. Patsy, I got no appetite. Today would have been our birthday. He's referring his brother, Spoons.
Philly,
who was killed by Gigi. I think it was season one.
At the behest of Tony Soprano.
Correct. He was talking shit about the Soprano family and about Livia trying to kill her son. So after he picks up Gigi from the airport.
So the twins were in Junior's crew. Is that how it worked?
Yes. Yeah. And they came over. They came over to Tony's crew. One of them did.
He talks about the twin bond, you know, which I've heard. You know, I worked with the Hughes brothers, great filmmakers. You know, on a movie. I worked with them on a movie called Dead Presidents, but they've done quite a few great films. But remember. They were telling me how when they were kids, they'd sleep in the same room. And very often they would have the same dream from different points of view, though. They wake up in the morning or like they dreamed of the same thing, but from like different points of view or something like that. Yeah.
That's pretty amazing.
The twin bond. Yeah, it's very, I just saw a thing in Instagram the other day, right? So there were these twins who were born and one was very sick. I mean, newborns, days old, had a problem with the heart or something. And they separated the twins because one needed more care, intensive care. And this nurse got this idea and took the healthy twin and put him in the crib with the sick one. And the healthy one started hugging the sick one.
Wow.
And in a very short amount of time, the sick one was cured.
Wow.
And there's a photograph of the healthy twin holding his sibling or her sibling and helped heal.
That's incredible.
Yeah. That's a true story, man.
That's incredible. You know, he's very sad, Patsy. He said, my brother was never a heavy with anybody. He was a gentleman. But he was a mobster. So somewhere along the line, he did something, right? And Christopher doesn't let it go. Don't it happen that identical twins a lot of time dive into a couple of these? You know, Tony feels a little guilty. It's very awkward. Gigi's trying to justify it. Hey, let it go. Christopher keeps on fucking fueling the fire there.
Tony also just doesn't like negativity. He doesn't want it around. He just wants, you know, business as usual, you know.
You know, Patsy says, I miss him so much. He's just about breaking down, kind of crying. And Tony has a good line. You want to commit suicide, tie your shoes and have a bite of Brajol. It's a joke. Tie your shoes because of what Paulie was saying. Right. And have a bite of Brajol because it's bad for you. John Fiore, who plays Gigi, is terrific in this episode.
Yeah, just he's terrific. A really good actor and very believable. And just, I love what he does with Gigi.
Does a great job, and you know, it's too bad he was gone too soon. You know,
his character
was gone too soon. He's done a lot of work. He was in Chappaquiddick, it's a good movie about Ted Kennedy,
right? He was in Law and Order, too, wasn't he? He had a
Law and Order before The Sopranos, role. And really good actor. And Ted Kennedy got away with murder, that fucking guy.
He certainly did, didn't
you? You saw that movie, Chappaquiddick?
No, I know the story.
Well, John Fiore plays a sheriff, and he does a great job, and Jim Gaffigan, but he just flat out got away with murder, Ted Kennedy.
Yes, he did.
Okay, the agents are following Carmella. Carmella and Adriana go to tennis lesson.
Yeah, and the tennis instructor says he's getting married and leaving, and Carmella seems kind of... Disappointed,
jealous. Absolutely. Like
she had a crush on him, and she's not a satisfied, satisfied with her marriage, it seems.
I think Carmella could get into trouble if a guy pursued her. I think she's...
Well, Furio does at some point.
But she's out there. She's kind of ripe, ready to maybe, and Adrienne is dressed like she's going to her. I don't even know where. That's not tennis attire. The agent likes watching Adriana. The agent with the binoculars. You know, it's funny, Carmella. He tells Carmella, you know, we're leaving. My wife's got this job. You know, can get a discount on antiques. And she goes, you know, my no antiques. My house is traditional.
We don't have antiques. Yeah.
Always the. Suburban housewife, at all moments there, where's that on her sleeve? Adriana, not a tennis attire. It's very funny.
She's also, doesn't know how to play.
No.
The new instructor, whose name is Brigitte.
Very provocative. She even comes on. She's not looking like the way a tennis instructor usually dresses.
No. And she takes a keen interest in Adriana's.
See, now you say it's sexual. I'm not
100%
quite sure.
It's sexual.
You know, I thought maybe it's more like, she thinks she's cool.
She's
got
her hands all over. I mean, but she's like brushing up against her. And
she's snubbing Carmella. I mean, flat out snubbing her.
She's very attracted to Adriana.
AJ leaves school. AJ's wearing a Pantera t-shirt. Pantera? What is
heavy,
that like?
Heavy metal.
Heavy metal. Yeah. Do you listen to that? You listen to Pantera?
I'm not a heavy metal fan.
And it's got the weed sign. What is that? Like a leaf? A weed
Marijuana.
Leaf? Marijuana. Okay.
Yeah. You got that, Dad? It's called marijuana. Kids smoke it. They get high.
Those hopheads. Those goddamn hopheads. I sound like, what was that? Those goddamn hopheads, what are they doing?
Grateful Dead.
The agent searches with an electronic listening device. We're back at the Soprano house. You'll see if the bug is going to work in the AC unit. So we're going back and back. So they're playing tennis, and the FBI is playing tennis.
Yeah.
back and forth, the family, them, it's boom, 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 boom.
It's a little too much, in my opinion. It's
a little confusing.
It's not that tense either, I have to be honest. I feel like this, that it was too much of the FBI, not enough of the usual Soprano stuff that we've come to know and love.
Well, that's why I think also they showed the two of them together. Yeah. You know, that's why it's episode one, episode two. Episode two is a little bit more traditional. You know, that's why they showed them together. We're at the outside the store, AJ and his friends. They're kind of smart asses, the friends. A little punky.
Yeah, they're
smoking cigarettes. You know, they're young. He talks about his friend comes out with the jersey. AJ goes, hey, nice jersey. He's on the football team. Friends are a little punky. Probably rich kids trying to act tough, listening to rap music, blah, blah, blah. You know.
Yeah.
You know, another guy that I saw, who I know you like, at a charity event, Snoop Dogg.
I did a photo shoot with Snoop Dogg.
And he's a good guy, nice guy.
We had a good time.
And me and Jim were at a charity in Vegas. And, you know, he wanted to see us backstage. And we went to his room, and it was just a fucking big cloud of smoke. But he performed a couple songs, and there's nothing worse than watching 50, 60, 70-year-old rich white people trying to dance to Snoop Dogg. I can't get the image out of my fucking head. I'm not kidding you. Rich, hey, white Vegas
everybody
people.
Loves Snoop Dogg. No, but there's not one person who doesn't like
but
Snoop.
Do you understand? Snoop Dogg is great. He does it all. Now he's got Corona commercials on.
Did you see him on American Dad? He plays like a Willy Wonka, but it's a weed factory. It's like Willy Wonka, but it's weed. Edibles that you can eat off the walls and all kinds of stuff. The it's hilarious.
He's great. He could do everything. Commercials, reality shows. All kinds of stuff, but I can't get the image of my head of these rich white people dancing to Snoop Dogg.
Why not?
Soprano's house. The agents are checking things out. The guy opens the fridge. He's looking at their mail. He opens the fridge. There's a nosy FBI agent there.
They want to, they're not supposed to do that, but of course they probably do, and who knows? I mean, I don't know. I would.
If there's I
was a guy.
There's an agent sitting outside of Meadows' dorm room.
Agent Malatesta, which means, headache or bad head. That's what it means. She's posing as a kid, as a student, and they're watching her very closely. You know, I mean, they're going to great lengths to keep tabs on everybody here.
You know, here comes her friend Caitlin, Meadows' roommate. She's singing. She's happy. She loves New York.
Played by Ari Grainer.
Great actress.
She did a really good job in this character, I thought. Really well done.
She was one of the leads in I'm Dying Up Here. It was on Showtime about the comedy business with Melissa Leo, produced by Jim Carrey. She was really, really good in it, an aspiring comic. Really good actress. She talks about Ruby Foos. Remember Ruby Foos?
I actually was there after a fight. I think it was after a Roy Jones fight. I was with my father-in-law, Richie, and we were hanging out with Queen Latifah one night there. Yeah.
Nice. Ruby Foos. It used to be good. It was good, Ruby Foos.
Yeah.
There was a couple of them in the city, uptown on the west side, and then in Times Square. Right? Yeah. She said she got hammered. She loves it. You know, she had a drink. She said she drank at 11:30 this morning. She's got a quiz. She hasn't even started studying yet. A lot of noise outside. Did you notice that? A lot of sirens, a lot of horns. Sirens,
yeah.
You know, they're up at Columbia, up in
114th Street, yeah.
You know. Here we are in the park. Liliana, the maid, and her husband. They're studying to become U.S. citizens. He's not happy. You know, he was an engineer in Poland, and he's driving a cab, and they treat him like shit. No one wants to listen to him. And he's upset. He's angry, rightfully so. And she stole the steak knives from the Sopranos.
And she's stealing several things. Yeah, she thinks.
Going to steal champagne glasses. She said they got so much stuff, like they don't even know what they got, you know. Agents are watching the video of Sopranos' basement. they see that the water heater is going to blow.
It's going to blow, yeah.
Lipari, Skip, I guess his father was a plumber. They're cracking jokes about AJ. They see the pasta. They laugh. It's all a big joke. It must be terrible having someone watching every little shit of your life. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and boring, repetitious, and just like, you know, day in, day out. I mean, you're dedicating so much time to this, and not a lot comes out of it, right?
Now there, yeah, we see the headquarters, FBI headquarters in Quantico, Virginia. They're going to put the microphone in this, they're a replica of the light in the Soprano basement. It's pretty amazing. They're painting it to look like an old one.
They're building the exact same thing with it, whatever, you know, damage on it and wear and tear on it. They're leaving no stone unturned. It's pretty amazing. Yeah.
Pretty amazing. Tony walks down the driveway, gets the paper again. He did all of these at once. They didn't keep going back to the driveway.
He did them all the same day, sure.
Of course.
Right.
He must have went down that driveway 40 times.
Yes.
You know. Okay, fellas and gals, our big day. They plan on putting the lamp in today with the microphone in it, in the basement. Bada bing, Tony arrives, Skip's outside.
So Gigi, this is a good scene for John Fiore, where he's telling that we got a problem with Patsy Parisi, that he's drinking a lot, he's depressed, they're worried. Well, I guess when someone does that, they go and, you know, they could say anything to anybody or do the wrong thing. He's suspecting Tony of having something to do with his brother's murder. Sylvia doesn't seem to worried about her. He's distracted, and that pisses Tony off a little bit.
Well, Silvio and Paulie are watching golf.
Right.
Paulie doesn't seem like the golf type. Stevie used to be a big golfer.
Yeah, and there's scenes with Silvio playing golf. There's a scene in season one, yeah. I think, where he plays golf. So
Silvio's a golf guy. He's not very interested. I like the scene. He's looking straight ahead. He's not looking at Tony when he's always a voice of reason, kind of. You know?
Yeah.
You know, what I do like, you know, Gigi, like I said, John Fiore does a great job. Him and Tony, great conversation. Patsy's a weak link. Like you said, anything can happen. But what I do like is Paulie says we always have the option. You know, Paulie's like that guy. There's all, you know, he gives you confidence. I used to have a mechanic. Dominic DeFalco. I would go to him. Dominic, I called him one time. I'm in California. Is the car going to make it back? It's overheating. Don't worry. You're going to be safe. He gave me.
He's a glass half full guy.
Like me.
Not a glass half empty guy.
Yeah. You know, and Paulie, it makes me feel good. You know, he's one of those guys. Don't worry.
We'll
I
take
got
care
your
of
back.
It, right? Yeah.
We'll take care of it. Don't worry, Skip. You know, and Paulie. Like I said before, you want him in the foxhole.
He's very capable, and when it comes down to it, he'll do whatever's necessary to protect the family, without a doubt.
So Carmela and Adriana again with the tennis lessons. Bridget teaches Adriana. She's criticizing Carmela.
And treating her like shit, yeah.
Carmela could do no right here, and she's very encouraging to Adriana. She makes Carmela pick up the balls.
While she's, you know, kind of standing behind Adriana, teaching her how to swing properly, getting very cozy and close.
Adriana keeps cursing. She doesn't know she's smoking. She's cursing. Yeah. Not tennis etiquette.
It's not in her cards.
Have you ever played tennis?
No, but I like tennis. I like watching tennis.
Yeah.
I like the U.S. Open. I've been to the U.S. Open. I like that a lot.
The Soprano, they get the call. Everyone rushes. Tony gets the call. Carmela gets the call. FBI doesn't know what's going on. There's an emergency. You hear the maid, oh, my God, oh, my God. And Tony gets the call. They leave. The bottom being rushes home. There's a flood in the basement. Water's got to be 2-3 feet high. Wedding pictures are ruined. He is pissed. He's hitting it with a golf club, is he?
I don't know. He's just really pissed off. It's a mess. There's all kinds of, she says save the pictures, which is always a very important thing. You want to save the pictures, but he's just, he's mad at her. You go, I told you not to put, you know, typical kind of, you know, you're blaming her. You, I told you not to put all this stuff down here. Like somehow now he knew this would happen. It's hilarious.
And it's a wedding picture. It's their wedding picture.
It's their prom picture even. Yeah. They went to the prom together.
Oh, is that what it was?
He says prom picture.
Oh, okay. I didn't catch that. All right.
Which, you know, I didn't know they went to the prom together.
The conference room, they don't know, have any idea what happened. Maybe we have a long-term problem. They don't know. They don't know what happened down there. It's an emergency. They don't know what.
And there's a couple of strange references to terrorism. They talk about they got to go. One guy's going to go deal with a mosque out in Denver. Someone else is talking about run it by anti-terror. This is maybe shot, you know, several months, 6 months or something before 9/11.
Before 9/11.
Before, wow. Yeah. Yeah.
The Cusumano house, they're dressed, FBI's dressed as the gas and electric workers. Jeannie opens the door. They're different for this neighborhood. She almost flat out comes out and tells them that they're in the mob. Why she would do that, I have absolutely no idea. Her and her husband are pain in the fucking asses.
Yeah, you really don't like...
I don't like the Cusumanos. I don't like the Cusumanos at all. Yeah. I like the actor and actress. I think
they did a
great
job. Yeah.
I like them.
They don't bother me as much as they bother you. But
They bother me, but that shows how good of actors they are. Because
they were both great.
Yeah. You know.
Actually, this episode aired March 2001, so it was probably shot a year before 9/11.
We started in August. Yeah.
We started in August, so like a year. Yeah.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely. Tony's eating sugar pops.
Tony likes cereal.
Likes cereal. Do you eat cereal? You like sugar pops?
Not sugar pops. I like Honey Nut Cheerios.
Nice.
Yeah, gluten free.
They have gluten free?
No, they are gluten. Oats are not gluten.
Oh, okay. There you go. Yeah, I like cereal, but my wife buys me that healthy shit I gotta eat, you know.
Honey Nut Cheerios are healthy and good for your heart.
Really? I'm going to have to tell her that.
Yeah.
Because she doesn't buy that for me. She's listening to this now probably too. I've been with my wife every single day, which we've gotten along fantastic, every single day since March. That's the longest we've been together every single day.
And every
single day.
No.
There's not, you know, usually, hey, there's been times I've been out on the road for 6 months.
Yeah, me too, of course.
6 months, you know, on and off, in and out, a month here, 2 weeks there. I've been with her every single day. She's a saint because she puts up with me. You know, I'm not that easy. I don't know if you know that.
I'm sure you're easy at home. This is all an act. It's your gruff exterior you like to portray. It's part of your shtick. I'm sure you're
right. All right, so we got they're eating breakfast. He brings them Shriadel.
Brings Shriadel.
Shriadel from Ferrara's.
Ferrara's in Mulberry, in Little Italy, Mulberry Street, right? Do you think he's referring to, when he says Big John Gotti?
Oh, I don't think so.
Or is this already, was Gotti already in jail at this time or what? No.
Yeah, I think he was. I don't know. Andy, find that out. But yeah, I think so. But I don't think he's talking about John. No. Gigi brings Friadel, which is an Italian pastry from Ferrara's for people that don't know out there. And Patsy, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, here comes Patsy. They say he's drunk. He points the gun like he's going to shoot Tony Soprano. He's got both of them there. And instead, he thinks better of it and pisses in the pool. He has the Wizinator. Is that the Wizinator?
No, he really peed.
Really?
That's what I read that in one of the books. Yeah.
Get out of here.
I have one of them. Let me see. Yeah, he really peed in the pool. In the book. It says it right here.
I don't believe that. That's the Wizinator.
Why does he not shoot him? Why does he change? What's the change of heart? I mean, obviously, it's a big step to shoot the boss. That's the end.
Well,
of
there's
his
one
life
thing problem. About thinking about. There's one thing about thinking about it. Thinking about it. I'm gonna fucking do this. Maybe Patsy's also lacking some balls.
Yeah. Maybe John Gotti was sentenced in 1992, so it's not John Gotti. Maybe it was John Webb Jr.
I don't think so. I don't think any of that. I have no idea. Tony says to Gigi, let's go downstairs and talk. That's a safe place. Let's go to the basement. I think maybe Patsy, drunk, thought better of it, or just got no balls, one or the other. Killing the boss, he's a dead man himself.
He's a dead man himself, and yeah, I guess.
Agent Harris arrives. He tells him what happened at the Soprano house. It was the water heater. I saw Ruggerio haul the old one out. That's how they figured that out. Ruggerio's the plumber. It's Mr. Ruggerio's neighborhood, hence the title. And next Tuesday, it's a go. This is where he says he's been Harpo Marx. We've had him tapped for 4 years. Tony doesn't talk.
But Harpo Marx did talk in real
life. In real life, yeah.
Did you ever
never
hear
on
talk?
Camera. Yeah, if you go on YouTube, you can hear him talk on something.
Really?
I've looked that up. There's clips, yeah. You hear him talk.
Were they really brothers?
Oh, yeah. You got Zeppo, Gummo, Groucho, Chico, and Harpo. Five brothers. I think Zeppo became an agent. He was part of the act for a while. He became an agent. I don't know, maybe Gummo too, but I know Zeppo became an agent.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. Agent Harris is on the side of the Soprano house. Tony passes, gives him the finger. This is it. Today's the day they're going to drop the wire in the basement. They're at the park. The maid and the husband, he's pissed off. He's still pissing and moaning. She had enough. She's going back to work. FBI's in a panic because they're in the house dropping this.
And this Fed tries to distract her and stall her, and he does not a good job.
Yeah. Yeah.
Asking her about the school.
It's an awkward scene. And also, I could be wrong. I don't know if she knew how to drive in real life.
Who the actress who played the maid, Liliana?
Yeah, yeah. I don't think she knew how to drive. I don't know if it was. I think it's in this scene. She was supposed to drive, and then, like, I think she was trying to learn. Got the pamphlet, like, trying to learn before the episode they were going to shoot how to drive and something like that. Yeah, I think it got a little hairy there. The tennis club, Carmela Adriana. The tennis lesson starts. The agent is like, this fucking guy is licking his chops. I mean, he's looking through the binoculars. Another skimpy outfit she's wearing. I mean, this Adriana has like no clue. She just doesn't care.
A little of both.
She must have seen how tennis players dress.
Yeah, she likes to be sexy, I guess. You know? Obviously.
The instructor gives Adriana a big hello. Carmela's not liking it. They both bend over to clean the sneakers. The FBI gets a shot of their asses, and
it's the highlight of his day.
Yeah, I mean, just a dish of schmo. Hey, they go into the basement. They install the lamp. They move the table. I mean, we're back and forth. It really is like tennis.
I guess so. Yeah,
back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Meadow's dorm room. Meadow comes with Hunter, her friend from home.
And Caitlin's burnt out and crashing hard.
And she's not thinking the same about New York. Somebody was eating chicken cacciatore on the train, spitting the bones. Let's hope that's the worst fucking thing they're doing. Believe me.
Yeah, it probably stunk, and you're sitting there. What's interesting is she says it was a blind man sitting next to him, and it must have smelled unbearable to him. And then when we cut to the pork store right now, there's a blind guy walking with a dog.
Oh, I didn't catch that.
Yeah, in the background. It's interesting. Interesting cut.
She's complaining about New York, that the luster has worn off of her being alone in New York City. You know, I mean, I would imagine when a kid you go to college, you go, I didn't go away to college, but you go away for the first time. You're like a kid in a can, you know, this is, you're away from your parents.
Freedom, yeah.
It's, you know, the freedom. And some kids, it takes them a while to adjust. And, yeah, you know, you can't go crazy. And there's some kids keep on going crazy.
Yeah, overboard.
You know, they go overboard and they can't handle it. And there's nothing worse than people eating on the train or on a plane. Like, you know, like people bring like smelly, like tuna.
They bring their own food.
Tuna salad or egg salad, you know.
Yeah, it's gross and inconsiderate.
The pork store, Tony arrives. Patsy, this is a really good scene.
Jim was really good in this scene. It really shows him taking charge, being the boss, taking care of business. This is how it's going to be. And, you know, everybody's got to get with the program here. It's good. Really good work.
He says, you got a problem with me? You know, tell me now. He says, no, Tony's grilling him. You got a problem? I think Patsy gets it loud and clear. Because if you got a problem, he's going to kill him. He mentions his son. He mentions his daughter.
He's not making, that making money. You're doing well.
Not it's that nice. Tony's going to do anything to the kids. Just that you want them to have a father, don't you?
Yeah.
Fucking get in line, and that's your story. That's enough. And he says, "Put your grief behind you." And Patsy says, "The grief's behind it." You know. Tony grills him. It's you know, hey. I mean, you're in the mob. I don't think there's time for that. That's part. That's an occupational hazard.
No, you got to get with the pro. I mean, he said that to Christopher a million times. You know, stop being distracted. You know, focus on the thing. You know, it's either you know, put up and shut up. Otherwise, you know, they'll get rid of you somehow. I mean, and there's a veiled threat there, definitely too. You know, it's like he's also saying he knows what's going on, and you know. But he's being the boss here, and he's, you know, he's being very clear, and he's just saying, hey, this could be a very good thing for you if you, you know, do the right thing.
And then he says, I'm going to get a coffee and a bun. Nobody calls them buns anymore.
They don't?
Nah, I don't think older people call them buns, you know, like you get a jelly donut or eclair, you know, you go to the bakery you get buns, right? You know, my mother used to say, go get a dozen buns, two dozen buns, you know, jelly donut, cream donut, eclairs, right? A bear claw, you know, all of that shit. You know?
They don't call them buns. We used to, my father did, yeah, when he used to go get that stuff on Sundays. Yeah.
Sundays, it was great.
Yeah.
Agents plant the lamp. Control, do you hear me loud and clear? Touchdown, they're happy, they're high-fiving. They're leaving the sausage factory, which is what they call the Soprano house. The sausage factory, that's where things get done. Football field, we see AJ trying out for the football team after he saw his friend with the jersey. He wants to be a part of that.
Another one of those quiet fade to blacks here between the football scene and the Soprano house.
Yeah, this isn't one of your favorite episodes, I could tell.
No, it's not. I'll be honest. I mean, listen, the least good Soprano episode is still better than most TV shows.
Of course, anyway, of course. But
no, I felt that, you know, there wasn't a lot of, it was too much of the FBI stuff, I felt. Way too much. And not enough of, you know, the other characters. And it wasn't all that tense to me, yeah. I'll be honest. I think the mashup of the two songs really kind of saved the day in a lot of ways. But not one of my favorites, no.
The Soprano house, Tony picks up the paper again. What the fuck? Agents in the van, they're listening to Tony talk. One of them is Glenn Kessler, Todd's brother, who's also a writer. I think he created Damages also with Todd.
He's a writer and producer with Todd Kessler, who is
He was with us in one of our Vegas debauchery trips.
He was, yes. Both Todd and Glenn came with us.
You were really drunk that trip. I remember that. You were extra drunk. I remember that one.
You remember me being extra drunk? Because you were straight. You weren't feeling anything. I'm sure we were drunk for days. Well, yeah. That's what you're doing, baby.
Don't even remind me. Please don't remind me. We're in the basement. Tony shows Stasiu.
Stassi was trying to get respect. See, back in Lodz, I had a grant from the state to do autonomous research. Nobody's paying attention.
Nah, I kind of feel bad for the guy. But yeah. Tony says you were an engineer. Maybe you could rig something up, a sump pump in the corner there, just in case. You know, the FBI, they're bored. They're reading the newspaper. And here comes Carmelo. Going to use the bike? No, you take it. But Tony, once again, I have a Russian girl coming over to take care of my mother. Where'd you find her? At the agency.
Irina's cousin. Yes. Svetlana.
He just can't do it on the up and up. He's got a fucking... No. He should have just went to an agency and got a Russian or whatever. Just get someone to help the mother.
He likes Svetlana. There was something about... Eventually they had a thing, didn't they?
Yeah, I think.
But he liked her, but he liked that she was, you know, a tough person, tough cookie, you know.
But it complicates things. But if Carmella finds that out, now you got to explain that.
Of course.
You know, now you got that. It's just fucking simplify, not him. Pile it on, man. You know, there's no Melfi in this episode.
No Melfi in this episode. That's right.
He doesn't go see Melfi.
Junior. Was Junior in this? No.
No Junior.
No Junior. No.
No Bacala.
No.
There's no Janice.
That's why I don't like it.
There's no Janice. There you go. You said the right thing. You didn't like my story with the chicken. You didn't like that chicken story. You got mad with my chicken story.
I didn't get mad. I just, you know.
You didn't like it. You don't have to laugh. You don't have to laugh. I'm just telling the story.
Would you rather?
I didn't make it up.
No, I know. You know what it is? It's a sad story.
It's a sad story.
Kind of pathetic. That's the thing.
I picture him pushing that trunk up the hill.
It's horrendous.
With a chicken outfit on. Yeah, I hired the fucking guy a lot. He never said thank you. Yeah. Don't fucking.
Another ungrateful
comic.
Fight against you. So ungrateful.
I hired the guy a million fucking times, pulled him out of a jam.
Great ending song here. Great closing credits. High Fidelity, Elvis Costello. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Maybe you got to bug my station. Very direct reference. But so I think the second time we used Elvis, the first time was Complicated Shadows in season one, I think. One of my great, that was a great concert. I saw him play solo concert in Santa Barbara at the Granada Theater.
Elvis Costello.
2012. What a great, just, you know, and you kind of forget all these song, you know, song after song. You're like, oh yeah, and that. I mean, he's.
You know, I sat next to him on a plane. He couldn't have been a nicer guy. He was great. He's a great musician, just not for me.
I love him.
It's not for me. Did you see this on YouTube? It's been going around. His father. His last name was McManus.
Was a musician, too.
And he's got a great video. Everybody, you should look it up. If I Had a Hammer, with like a 13-piece band, it's fantastic.
Is Elvis with him?
No. This is when his father was younger.
Was and performing. He's
got a white outfit on. Fantastic. Yeah, If I Had a Hammer. Yeah. You got to see cool. that. He looks very much like Elvis Costello.
Declan McManus is Elvis's real name.
Yeah. Really, really good. Really, really good. Well, listen, I'm sorry you were disappointed in the episode.
It happens.
But, you know, there's a beautiful picture, rendition of us that we brought to life. That guy said nice pictures.
Oh, you got to send me the pictures, man.
I'll send
you
the pictures.
When you get this stuff, you got to share it. You can't just keep everything to yourself.
I just shared it with you.
I could barely see it through the computer screen.
I'm going to get you a better shot.
You could email me or whatever.
Okay. You know, I will do that.
All right. It is time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA Best Question of the Week is Leo. From Ontario, Canada, we're going to send Leo a pair of Bose headphones.
Now, Leo asks, hi, Steve and Michael. Great job on the new podcast. My question, I've always wondered, how much on average do you think Tony makes per year as head of the family? He lives in a nice neighborhood with doctors, so I assume about the same. 200 to 300 a year, maybe 400 in a very good year. What do you guys think?
That's a really good question.
He's from Canada, but we're talking American money here.
U.S. And are we talking money from 20 years ago, or are we going to adjust it to inflation in today's? No, we're talking from then. I bet it varies a lot from year to year. That's for sure, depending on what's going on and how things are going. But I would say in the half million range.
At least. I mean, he's got the garbage routes.
And it goes up, though, over the course of the show, because he, you know, he becomes the boss.
I mean, he's got the garbage routes. He's got this wabistics going on.
The bada bing, the pork store.
He's got the bada bing, the stuff in the pork store. He's getting kicked up from
unions.
Christopher, unions, the reverend. He's got Christopher kicking up Paulie. Silvio.
Bookmaking, gambling.
I mean, I think he makes, I'd say he makes over $1 million a year.
Over a million.
You know, a lot of money goes to attorneys. A lot of, you know, he spends a lot of money on his gomada, if that's the only one he has.
How much is in cash?
He's got a boat. He's paying at least at the time 50, 60,000 a year for middle school.
Yeah.
For college. Carmela's, whatever the hell she's spending every day. It's a lot of money. I mean, he's got
cash, right? Mostly?
Oh, sure. He's got to show something. That's why he's got the garbage route.
He's on the books on the garbage.
He's on the books at the Baron Garbage at private sanitation. Make a fortune. I can't imagine he's not making $300-400 from the garbage alone.
Right.
You know, he's got businesses with New York. He's got all kinds of scores coming and going. Hijackings. And you know, we do see as the series goes on, especially season 2 and 3 and so on, when he becomes the boss. I mean,
and then it's later on, they're talking about the Esplanade, these big, construction projects. And, you know, but what do you think Bacala makes?
Oh, I think Bacala barely makes 6 figures. He's grinding it out, grinding a living. He gets paid by Junior.
Two grand a week.
Maybe, you know, Junior gives him, something. And then whatever little side hustle he could grab. At the moment, Bacala's just a driver. He's just a schlepper, gopher. He may not even. He might make $50,000 if he's lucky. Grinding it out. You know, everyone thinks if you're on TV, you're rich. They also think if you're in the mob, you know, they see diamonds and pinky rings. It's really just the big bosses that make the money. You know, it's almost like multi-level marketing. The bottom guys kick up to those guys, kick up to those guys. Like, you know, Paul Castellano had all the money. These other guys are out there trying to – don't you remember in Donnie Brasco, the Pacino character? I mean, didn't they have a parking meter? They were trying to get. Never saw it, Donnie Brasco.
I got to see that. That's one
okay, so things. There's a scene where they're in their club trying to break open a parking meter. I mean, how much is in a parking meter?
Right.
You know.
But I imagine there's times when there's big scores, right? There's a truck and there's a high, you know, and then all of a sudden they'll spend a lot or you'll buy.
Well, Goodfellas, right?
Shows that really well, all that stuff, yeah.
Goodfellas, they had that big score. They all got, you know, they all got healthy and wealthy, you know.
And then they spend it.
They spend it. You got all kinds of shit. And a lot of them have gambling habits.
Yeah.
You know, not so much drug habits, you know, in the 80s that went on some, but big gambling habits. That's a big part of it. They like to show off the Cadillac, the big house.
Vacations.
You know, where do they go? Down to Miami Beach.
They go to Miami. Yeah, I guess.
There you go. Leo, enjoy. It's a good question. And I would say, I think Tony does better than that. But like you say, I think it's up and down.
It's up and down, but you know, he could bank on close to $1 million a year, you think?
Listen, even Uncle Junior, he was going to give Melvoin
$400,000.
He wasn't happy about it, but he didn't blink.
I didn't want a bigger house, a nicer house, nothing. Just stay in that old
shitty yellow green phone.
Depressing house.
Depressing down the basement. Hey. You know, it's more of the lifestyle. The this is what they do. You know, a lot of these old timers, it wasn't about the money. It's about the code of honor and et cetera, et cetera.
The status, the power. You know,
they walk down the block, they get the respect, right?
Right.
All right. Well, thank you, Leo. Enjoy Canada, my friend. Enjoy your headphones.
All right. And we already did the credits, so we don't have to do them again.
We should do them one more time.
Do them a good
one. One more time.
Really?
Do the credits.
All right. We'll do the credits. We're doing two credits in one episode. Go ahead. All right. Start us off.
Thanks for listening. And remember, new episodes are released every Monday. Please subscribe to the Talking Sopranos podcast on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram and like us on Facebook. And right now, you can get official Talking Sopranos merchandise on TalkingSopranos.com or through our YouTube channel.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman. Producer is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amatin. You can hear more of Elijah's music and also the band Zopa, which Elijah and I are in together. You can click on the links at TalkingSopranos.com. Our production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
All right, man. It was great hanging with you, even though you're in a little weird mood today. I think because the hairline, you got a little annoyed. Because that guy made you look like you're going bald.
Did he really? I mean, I can't see the picture. You put it up. I mean, you think that set me off? I'm in a weird mood of the episode. It's not my favorite episode. What do you want me to say? Some are better than others. They're not, you know, they're not all on the same level of,
well, how could they possibly be? The bar is set so high.
Of course.
Just impossible.
You're gonna have great ones, you're gonna have not great ones. I thought Hate is a Hit is one of my least favorite ones too, I have to say.
Well,
even though I'm in that one a lot, I don't, that episode
is that the one with
Bokeem Woodbine, who was great. It has nothing to do with the acting. I just thought somehow it doesn't hold up as good as the other ones, you know.
Listen, 86 episodes. I mean, you know, like you said, even a not so good Soprano episodes is better than everything on TV.
Pretty much anything else. Yeah, I agree.
All right, man. See you later. I will talk to you soon.
Yes, sir.